Welcome to Pure Cinema Channel. Today we have Senil Kumar Sasidharan, the most important independent filmmaker of India. And right now he has just completed the upcoming movie Varak. And also the Kayatam is screening in several film festivals also. He is a creator, has a strong political view. And we are happy to have in Pure Cinema Channel Filmmaking A to Z. So when I searched about you at first, you're known to many persons as an Indian poet. So how this writing poems and everything, how you introduced yourself into a literary world? What are the writers you have inspired so much?
Poetry is something, you know, I think it is the basic point of every art. That is what I feel. Take it film, take it drama, take it you know, painting, whatever. I think the basic content of that is poetry. So film is too much connected to, artistic films are too much connected to poetry. But I'm a poet without even a single book in my name. So that is an irony, and people call me a poet. It's good. Anyway, yeah, I have written almost 200, 300 poems. In my blog, I started writing from my school days only. But in 2007, I went to Middle East. At that time, I had a lot of time. I was working there as an administrator. So after office hours, I had a lot of time. So I was bored and I had a lot of things to express. So that's why I started writing poems regularly. Like I used to write 3 to 4 poems per day. It was like crazy, and people consider writing too much or creating a lot of art or a lot of, you know, something you call art is some is a bad thing to have. So I don't know why people think like this, because still a lot of people ask me how can you make this much of films. I have made 7 films in 6 years. So people are asking how fast you are. And I don't know, it is a part of my life. Poetry also is like that.
So you worked as a lawyer and then you came to this filmmaking process. You have done a lot of short films also, and then you came into feature films. Your films do have some unique languages comparatively in independent film. When I see in all the independent films, your film have some unique languages, and the dialogues are like a cutthroat. The reality slap for the audience. Those dialogues, all these things, right? How you do this writing process? Because you have mentioned that you have done 2 of your films without script. So how this writing process goes?
I think film also is a reflection of life. So we are living a scriptless life, right? We are not living a life full of script. So it's a scriptless exercise. So I think filmmaking also can be like that, because I am concentrating on reflecting life, maybe my life or life surrounding me or somebody whom I know. So I think there is no need for script, that hardcore, hardbind script. But while you try to understand what is cinema and how to express that kind of emotion through the medium of cinema, eventually you will understand the language, the grammar. And it is not a learning process. It is like, you know, you are understanding slowly. It is just like a child learning a language. And a child start learning a language not through its grammar. It's by acquaintance, right? It observes how it happens and how it communicates and what is the power of that. So that is very natural kind of thing. It doesn't need any kind of education.
Who's your favorite film director? Because you're not chosen commercial cinema. You have chosen an independent filmmaking.
Yeah, there are many filmmakers who actually influenced me a lot. In Kerala, Adur Gopalakrishnan and Bharathan. I was a great fan of Bharathan, Padmarajan. There are a lot of filmmakers in Kerala. And also in 1998, I started watching international films in the International Film Festival of Kerala. From there, I got Makbul Buff and Michael Haneke and Kieslowski. Kieslowski is my favorite. And there was 10 films, 10 decalogues by Kieslowski. And I, when I started watching this from the beginning only, I felt that, you know, there is another kind of language, another kind of film. And I can relate that kind of passion in my life and my attitude towards cinema. I don't know how it came, no idea, because I have seen a lot of filmmakers' films. But this is, Kieslowski's films are totally different. They are too intense, very real, and you know, very dark. It is, Kieslowski never tries to, you know, make people peaceful. He makes people restless. And I feel that it is a kind of process that he purifies our minds. And that's why I feel, you know, cinema, people call cinema sometimes dark, but dark cinema has a power to purify souls. That's what I felt when I see his films. And I think I'm hugely influenced by this filmmaker.
In one interview, he also mentioned that who's your favorite director, they were asked. He was telling Franz Kafka and Dostoevsky. That was totally different. So he's very connected with the literature work. He's telling that there is no cinema without literature work. Literature work is the only base. So how you're connected with the literature work?
I don't feel that literature is too truly connected to cinema. Cinema is totally different. Cinema is a pure art, but it is an aggregator. You know, it aggregates everything, every kind of art. But it makes something truly different from any other art. You can take any form of art and you can make it as a part of this cinema. But the emotion finally it makes will be totally different. You can't find it any other places. That is the power of cinema. But I think literature also is our, you know, endeavor to our trial to, you know, make it available for the generations. That is what literature is meant for. That's what I feel. It is not like just storytelling or you know, writing some verses. It is not like that. It is like marking our experiences for our generations. And cinema is also like that. Cinema is also like that. And the cinema takes whatever experiences you get from literature, you get from poetry, you get from plays, paintings, whatever. Cinema can take all these experiences and it can transform it into another form of art, which is truly sublime. That is what I feel. Yeah, and Olivu Divasathe Kali also, even though it is a very intense short story, I have only taken the nutshell of that. I have not taken the entire short story as such. I've taken the soul of that and made into my film. I have added a lot of characters into it, a lot of things like election I brought into it. The one important character in the film is the television.
Okay.
And I have not subtitled it in my film. It is too complicated because already there are a lot of information comes in the form of dialogues. So if you try to subtitle every dialogue, including the television conversations, it will be too much of information. I don't think that people like it. A few people like you may be, you know, interested in that. So I thought I'll leave it. And if people who are interested in that, they will try to translate it. That is the fate of cinema. If cinema survives, I think people will go to it again and again and find different aspects of that. And they will also spend energies, their energy for, you know, giving a lot of support to that cinema. So I hope that happens.
Yeah, when you done the first film, Morapukam, it was a whole crowdfunded film. You might, through Facebook, you have collected the fund. You need a contact and a friend zone because throughout this film, you are doing with your friend zone and a crew, same crew members and also different crew members. This team is very important. You tell me about your crew members, how you people work starting from the Oral Pokam and now, how this works goes, because you have done a crowdfunded film, which is Till now, they're saying that in Malayalam, the first crowdfunded film at this decade is Senil Kumar.
I think the first crowdfunded film in Malayalam was Amma Ariyan by John Abraham.
Yeah.
And after that, actually, I'm inspired from his work, John Abraham's work, Amma Ariyan. And I thought, if he can do in that time, why can't we do at this time? Because this time people are connected with the internet and social media, and it is easy to find like-minded people. So that's why I thought I will try to collect some people who are having same kind of mindset, and ask them to give support. Auralpukkam was a big success in that kind of making crowdfunding, and it was a difficult experience for us while making. Because now people are asking, some people are asking about the money part and all. So I think it is very difficult to make people come together for a cause and lead them always together. It is very difficult. So that's why in my second film, I find a proper producer, Shaji Matthew. And from there onwards, I have a producer. Shaji Matthew was the producer till my last film, Kaitam. And the new film I am working is with another person.
Okay.
So crowdfunding is a good idea, but you need to have similar kind of people, people with same kind of mindset, and it should last forever. Otherwise, some people might be coming with some interest. Maybe somebody see an opportunity to act, or some see an opportunity to be a part of that film later on. And if they are disappointed somehow, and it can make some kind of difficulties, like it hurt emotionally. So there is a chance of this. Crowdfunding has this kind of problem also. So I thought, I need to find a producer. Anyway, I am making independent films only with a small budget.
So when you are talking about John Abraham, he was running a movement called Odisha. Now you are running Kacha Film Movement. And also this movement doesn't have this only thing that filmmaking. They do have they creating that awareness between the people, how they want to see this film. What is the connection between the film and the political causes which is happening right now, and also the film appreciation? Everything need to be taught or have to be explained to the people through movement. So I just want to know, what is the actual role of this movement, and what are the needs? Because in Kerala there are a lot of movements, including Kacha. In Chennai also we have Tamil Studio. So what is the role of these movements? What are the importance and need of these movements?
Honestly, I am not part of Kacha now. I resigned from Kaisha last year. But Kaisha is an important entity in Malayalam independent cinema field. We have done a lot of things. Kaisha has done a lot of things. And it produced not only my film, it produced another film, Eli Eli Lama Sabachthani, by Jiju Antony. And it tried to produce a film by Women Crew. And we run Cinema Vandi across the state for propagating cinema. And Kaisha has done a lot of things. So I think these kind of entities, these kind of organizations are a must for artistic cinema. Artistic cinema has no space in our country, actually. People say that artistic awards are for artistic cinema. It is not like that. For at least for 5 to 6 years now, we keenly observe artistic cinema has no space at all. So these kind of organizations which is totally dedicated to artistic cinema is a must for the existence. I know Tamil Studio are also working in the same direction. I have participated in the festival, and my two films have been screened in Chennai. And I felt that a lot of people, more than people in Kerala, cherish my films in Tamil Nadu. And it is because of these kind of organizations like Tamil Studio and some individuals who really wanted to support my kind of films. And this is very important to have such organization and their existence. in my personal case, I feel that I need to get some time and space for myself. So that's why I'm secluding myself.
There is two sorts of schools in filmmaking, they say. One is from Hitchcock, where he's very clear in storyboard and what are the scenes he's going to take. In everything, he'll be fine. In another thing is Werner Herzog, where he doesn't have any storyboard or any script. He just go into the location, he just create whatever he have in his mind with the normal people, not even trained actors. So which one is very close to you?
I don't know any of this. I really don't know any of this. And I don't know the techniques of filmmaking. And honestly, I feel ashamed to say this. I am totally unaware of any kind of, theories of cinema. I just go to this location, having some idea in my mind. And at the location, I instantly change. And I can feel that people are becoming embarrassed. My crew, you know, they will be prepared for something I have already explained. But in the location, I suddenly change it into something else. So they will be embarrassed. So I don't know from where it is all happening. So I don't know. I don't understand these theories.
So I just want to know how this dialogue writing will go. Because some of your scenes are like, for example, in Sexy Durga, the conversation with the police with these two guys are totally natural. It's not, I thought this is not scripted. It was totally natural. But comparatively, when we talk about in Oral Pakkam, between the relationships you are giving, you know, you're not the real person, you're pretend to be someone else. These conversation, which was written by you, that was very clear. So how do you manage these things? Because some you say that to the actors that you go with this flow, or at some places you want to grip this script and want to place some dialogues in your script.
There are a lot of characters, you know, characters with a lot of differences, a lot of variants. And you see a lot of people around you, including you. You also is a character. You know, the maker also is a character. And there are a lot of people around you. And sometimes you can give freedom to other people so that they can bring their experience into a character. But in Oral Pakkam, Mahendran is a character who I can really understand. Maybe a representation of myself. I think it will be more justifiable if I contribute my kind of thought process and my kind of dialogues. That's why I planned that kind of dialogues. Even when Maya is talking, that also I feel that I need to contribute to that character, because Maya also has Maya also is part of my being, my
your character.
So aesthetic being. Yeah. So that's why I thought these two characters must speak my language or my kind of dialogues.
In Oral Pakkam, you have given a poetic narration in the end, where the woman, how the woman dies will be very poetic. That scene will be very poetic. So you are always connected with this poem. In Umayunda Maranam also, when I saw the film, how the film flows itself, it's a surrealistic fantasy thing, the flying, all these things. When they start with this storytelling narration, and also the way the film goes itself a different way. It always created with this poetic lines. So how you include these poems and poetic lines, even in Oli Desathukali, where he talks about the poem, where black poem he mentions. So what are why you want to give that kind of end to this Oral Pakkam?
For me, cinema is poetry only. Cinema is a variant of poetry. And every art is essentially poetry only. That is what I feel. Unless you try to commercialize or attract a crowd, you can find poetry in every kind of art, be it painting, be it drama, be it film or whatever. It is poetry. So actually, I have a close association with poetry. I like poetry very well. And poetry has a characteristic that it expresses something, but it imbibe or it hides something inside. That is the characteristic of poetry. So you can't read it at one point. Maybe you will be reading something, you know, periphery at one point, and later on you identify, oh, this is something hidden there. So that is the characteristic of poetry, and I wanted to bring that characteristics into my film. That's why people say my film has, you know, different kind of reading possibilities. And that is truly because of this poetry, the element of poetry. And I don't know if I have succeeded fully in, you know, utilizing that capability of poetry completely, but I'm trying, still trying. And maybe I don't know how many years I can survive like this, or I can, you know, make films, or I can leave. But through whatever, how many years I can leave, or how many films I can make, I will continue to try bringing the poetry, essential elements of poetry into my films. That is my trial.
So you give too much importance to the location. When I saw one of your interview, you were mentioned that in Olivu Desithikali, you just begged that police that you really wanted that place, or else I can't make that film. So what are the importance you give to the location? How you hunt the locations?
Location is also like, I think location is more important than characters, artists. Location also plays a lot of role, because it is all, we are all fragments of energies. That is what I feel. We are all fragments of energy, and this energy bring the elements together. That forms our body and mind and all. That's like that. Cinema also has a lot of elements of energy. Artists bring some energy, location brings some energy, and camera movement brings some energy, music brings some energy. So these are all very essential. Like at least artists and locations are artist, location, and subject. These are all you can't take anyone or anything, any element very silly. These are all very important factors. For me, for a film, and these three elements, like artist, location, and the subject matter, is very essential elements. You can't, maybe you can make a film without a camera, or you can use your mobile phone camera, but without a proper location or proper artist and the subject matter you want to say, you can't make a film.
So we have completed the Varak right now, and it's from Oralpakkam to Varak. How you see this transition? Because it's been like it'll be a toughest thing from there to here without script and do experimental film. You are chosen the path that I want to do independent films. So how was this journey?
No, I don't know how it happens. The evolution happens. I don't know. I'm very passionate about filmmaking. After 6-7 films, I feel that I have a lot of things to do in filmmaking, because each time I finish a film, I feel that it could have been much better. I could have make it much better. And once a film is made, you can't do anything with it. There are a lot of limitations. So it is a film. So let it live. That is the only thing you can do. And you can make another film. And maybe you can, try your expertise, or make use of your experiences in another film. That's why it evolves. Sometimes it evolves in a positive way. Sometimes you'll become very, security conscious. You need to appease people a little bit more. If somebody do not like your previous film, then that also come into your mind while making another film. And it will make your a kind of influence to deviate from your basic thought process. And all these things take part in that evolutionary part. And I feel that till now I'm not interested in money making through films. And I feel I have enough money to live, and that doesn't mean that I have a huge bank account, but I'm happily living, and it's okay for me. And only thing I am looking forward is to make much better films than I have made so far. So until now, it is good.